This is me shooting a text to my phone from a custom-built laser tag gun. Now you may ask, why on earth would you want to build that? And I have no good reason to give. All you need to know is that you've been lied to. Laser tag guns don't use lasers. They're actually just big long-range TV remotes using flashing infrared light focused into a beam. Have you ever been to play laser tag and at the end you get to see a leaderboard with your number of kills, who shot you the most, etc.? They can do that because the guns are sending little messages when they shoot. Maybe something like a hit signal and an ID for the gun that made the shot. When I learned that, it made me think, if these are just little message-sending devices, could I make them do other stuff? Like send texts, turn someone's TV off from a distance, maybe transfer a file? To answer that, I've got to figure out how these things work. These are laser tag guns I've had for a really long time. Nerf made them in about 2008. And they're so fun, and you don't need vests because the sensor's right on the gun. Which, yes, makes it pretty easy to cheat. But I'm getting sidetracked. Let's take one apart and see what we're looking at. Actually, before that, let's see if we can read what information it's sending. This is an infrared receiver like what might be in your TV, and it can turn the modulated infrared light pulses into an electrical signal that we can do something with. We provide power to this pin. This pin goes to ground to complete the circuit, and the data goes out on this pin. So if we hook it up properly and configure some stuff on this Raspberry Pi, which is just a tiny computer, we can hit the power button on a TV remote and see what data it's sending. You can see it's just a bunch of lines that say pulse or space and a number. And like everything, it's all just ones and zeros in the end. A pulse means the infrared light is on, and a space means it's off. And this number is how many microseconds that on or off lasts. There are different protocols, but with this remote, if we see a short pulse followed by a long space, we'll read it as a 1. And if we see a short pulse followed by a short space, we'll read it as a 0. So this remote's power button is sending this message. This longer pulse and longer space at the beginning act like a header for the start of the message, and this extra pulse at the end acts like a marker for the end of the message. So what message is the gun sending? Sweet. So on solo mode, it shoots this, team 1 shoots this, and team 2 shoots this. Okay, that's really promising. We can read what it's shooting. But if we're going to change the information it's shooting, we'll have to be able to send a signal we've created ourselves. I've got an infrared LED hooked up, and I wrote some code to take the pulses we recorded and send them to the LED. Actually, here, I'll show it first with a normal LED. Now, infrared light isn't visible for humans, but a fun little trick you can do is use your phone camera. You can try it out with a TV remote. So let's see what our LED is doing. Did you see that tiny light? This LED is going to need a lot more current to power it. If I redo the circuit and add in a transistor, this little guy, we should be able to boost the current so it's brighter. Much better. All right. Let's see if we can hit this gun with an LED and some code. All right, okay, now we're getting somewhere. Now we've got a simple proof of concept, so I think it's time to tear this thing down. All right, here's what it looks like inside. We've got our triggers, a reloading mechanism, and the LED coming out of the control board. And it's going through what's called a collimating lens that turns the light from the LED into a straight beam. To make sure we get everything working, let's try and shoot it while it's open. Found it. When this little contact is touching, it seems to think you're reloading. So if we hold that open, maybe it'll work. I'll jerry-rig it now to keep everything in place. Cool. Now we've read the infrared pulses with a receiver. But what does that mean for what's actually getting sent to the LED? Because that's what we need to replicate. All it's got connected to it are these red and black wires. There's two things we can check on these wires, the voltages and the current. Starting with the voltage, which should show us the signal that's being sent, we'll use this little guy. This is an oscilloscope, and at a basic level, it measures voltage over time. We can check a voltage with this multimeter, but the oscilloscope will graph the changes in the voltage. I'm actually pretty happy I found this. Last time I touched an oscilloscope, I was in college, and like even a budget normal one is a few hundred dollars. And this was like 30 or something and is getting the job done. Okay, let's shoot the gun with it connected. There we go. We can see the pulses we're talking about. And look, if you remember, we said combinations of long pulses and short pulses represents our ones and zeros. This isn't measuring it perfectly, but you can kind of see we've got a long pulse followed by a really long space, long pulse, long space, then short pulse, long space, 7 times. I've got to assume these short ones just aren't being measured correctly, or I've got a setting wrong. On to the current. When you measure current, you've got to break the circuit first. The current is going to determine how bright the LED flashes, and I think will be the main factor in the range when we shoot it. Looks like the gun's doing about 18 milliamps. So what's our little circuit doing? 3.59 milliamps. Transistor was backwards. Now we're getting close to 15. Not exactly the same, but a lot closer. Good enough for me. And yeah, you can see the LED is brighter now. And we've proved that we can hit a gun with our circuit, so the oscilloscope should show the exact same thing. A little noisy, but close enough for me to believe it's the same. Now I think we're really getting there. We can receive infrared pulses and replicate pulses. Now we've got to get the gun to shoot those pulses. Let's test if we can do that with the LED from the gun. Test one, replicate the laser tag gun. Test two, replicate the TV remote. Oh, that's so satisfying to see working. Okay, that's great and all, but my idea is to try and shoot text to a phone. So that's what I took the next couple of days to figure out. And it was all just coding and testing, so kind of makes for a really boring video. Let me walk you through how the code works instead. So what we know we can do is send different length infrared pulses and pick them up with a receiver and read out what pulses were sent, and we can interpret those as ones and zeros. If we have the ones and zeros, we should theoretically be able to encode anything we want. One encoding system that you may have heard of is ASCII. And it's one way to map numbers to characters. For example, with ASCII, the numbers 97 through 122 map to lowercase a through lowercase z. But if all we have is ones and zeros, how do we send 97? For normal numbers, we use a base 10 system and represent the numbers with the digits 0 through 9. And each digit place represents a power of 10. So for 3,854, each place represents how many of that power of 10 we have. 10 to the power of 0 is 1, so we have 4 ones. 10 to the power of 1 is 10, so we have 5 tens, or 50. 10 to the power of 2 is 100, so we have 8 100s, and so on. But all we have is an LED that's on or off, or 1 or 0. So we need to use a binary system. Every digit can only be either 1 or 0. And instead of 10 digits to use, 0 through 9, we only have 2, 1 and 0. So if we replace all our 10s with 2s here, we can see what each digit in binary represents. First, how many 1s we have, then how many 2s we have, then how many 4s we have, how many 8s we have, etc. So counting looks like this. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. So to send a lowercase a with ones and zeros, we map from 97, which looks like this, and we can do that for every character in our message. This is just one way to encode our message, and after implementing it, I ended up switching to something called Huffman encoding, which compresses the message down so we don't have to send as many ones and zeros. But at the end of the day, we type our message, encode it into ones and zeros, convert the ones and zeros into pulses and spaces, fire those pulses and spaces with infrared light over to our receiver phone, decode them back into ones and zeros, and output the text on the phone. Now it's time to wire everything up into the gun, take it outside, and see if we can shoot some text messages. Thank you. some of you may realize the issue I'm going to run into on my first day of testing. Guess what causes a ton of infrared interference? So I definitely had some trouble with this midday, but I got some text to show up. You'll have to forgive the dull phone screen. I dropped it in a river.
Oh!
But the gun works really well indoors in the dark. Here's a shot from like 30 feet. And I wasn't satisfied with that first day of testing, so I went out again in the morning after debugging some technical issues. And from that day first, here's a little overconfident test when I hadn't plugged in the USB correctly. But we finally got some working shots in the daytime, and you can see that there's still some errors from interference or my aim. And now that I'm editing, I think a little shade cover for the receiver could have done wonders. But either way, I'm pretty stoked I got this working from just a stupid little idea. Thanks for watching, I hope you learned something, and if you like that, go check out my other video where I restore a guitar I built in high school.